Hello, I'm United States Surgeon General Jerome Adams, and I'm so pleased that you're with us for a conversation with Admiral Brett Giroir, the Assistant Secretary for Health, to talk about an issue that, Dr. Giroir, I know is near and dear to your heart, sickle cell disease. Thank you for joining us here today.
It's great to be here with you today.
Absolutely. Well, we know that sickle cell disease affects 100,000 people across this country. September is Sickle Cell Awareness Month. If you were talking to someone who didn't know anything about sickle cell disease, what would you tell them?
First of all, as you said, 100,000 people in America have sickle cell disease. And what sickle cell disease is, it's a genetic disease. And in fact, it's the first disease that we characterized at the genetic and molecular level. But unfortunately, that defect in the gene causes a problem with the blood. And when you have a problem with the blood of sickle cell disease, it affects almost everything in your body. You're prone to infection. You have bouts of pain that are just excruciating over periods of time. You can have problems with your lungs, with your digestive system. You're at risk for strokes. And unfortunately, even though we know a lot of things and we do better than we did beforehand, unfortunately, people with sickle cell disease tend to live shorter than most people. And on average, their lifespan is only in their late 30s or early 40s. So it really is an important health problem that we want to tackle.
Wow. Now that's the science behind sickle cell disease. But tell me about sickle cell disease on a patient level. As physicians, we all remember few patients from our time who have really impacted us. Has there been a particular patient who's impacted you?
One thing about you and I, we always remember the patients. Mm-hmm. It's not really statistics, and I know we've had this conversation before that we see patients' faces and their families every time we talk about a statistic. And with sickle cell disease, I see very many, but one certainly stands out to me. Her name is Shamanika, and she was a patient of mine intermittently. I'm a pediatric critical care physician, and she had sickle cell disease. And unfortunately, she had just about every complication you could have with sickle cell disease, from infections to severe pain to problems with her spleen. And she was in the hospital a long time, and many, many times. And most people, you know, you can get down by that or you can get discouraged, but she always had an enthusiasm and a courage to move forward. And from the time she was about 6 years old, she wanted to grow up to help other people with sickle cell disease. Hmm. And it just so happens my wife and I were her mentor. So we not only took care of her in the hospital, but we helped mentor her through her adolescence and young adulthood. And we're still very much in contact with her. And I can say now, she's a young woman. She still suffers from sickle cell disease, but she's dedicated her life to helping others with sickle cell disease, to educating people with the disease, to educating the public, and to really to try to make life better for all those with sickle cell disease. So she's a very special person.
Wow, patient advocacy is so very important. HHS, Dr. Giroir, has made sickle cell disease a top priority. It's one of your top priorities. Why now?
Why now is a very easy question to answer, and that is because we have the capabilities now, both organizationally, leadership-wise, with new drugs, potentially even a cure coming down the road, that we could really make a difference. So we can't let this opportunity go by. If we have an opportunity to help 100,000 people who have a chronic disease, who have not benefited as much from the advances of science as other diseases, this is the time to really do it. So I think with your leadership here as the United States Surgeon General, with the leadership of the Secretary, with our office, Office of Minority Health, we have brought together the first of its kind partnership among all the federal government agencies with the private sector, professional groups, and patient advocacy groups to really impact this disease. So I could not be more excited about the opportunity or more serious about our passion and dedication to achieving results for these patients.
You mentioned a cure. How close are we?
I talked to Dr. Francis Collins, the director of the NIH, and he really tells me that the science is there, and he means this, and I told him I'm going to hold him to it, that there's going to be a genetic cure for sickle cell in 5 to 10 years.
Wow.
And he thinks it's more closer to the 5 year. Other people say it's closer to the 10 year. But what that means is it's a scientific cure. What we really need to do is, if there's going to be a scientific breakthrough that could potentially cure sickle cell disease, we've got to clear that pathway for that scientific cure. And what I mean by that is we need to make sure we have clinical trial networks so we don't delay doing the clinical trials by 3, 5, or 10 years because we are not organized. We need to make sure that the regulations are in place at the FDA so these cures can be fast-tracked, that we know how to get them approved according to FDA regulations. And very importantly, we have to understand how to pay for them. There may be cures, but they're going to be expensive because they're going to be genetic cures. And we need to think about paying for that right now. And finally, the guidelines now, if we're only following it 25% of the time, and these are pretty simple guidelines, like what kind of pill to take in order to prevent complications, how are we going to expect people to follow guidelines with complex genetic cures that are going to need a lot of follow-up? So even if you have a cure, it doesn't mean it's implemented or followed up right or there's not complications. So we really need to get everybody on the same page today with the simple things we can do, follow that 100% to pave that way.
Tremendous. Now, short of a cure, what would you say to the average practitioner or a public health advocate in the community in terms of steps that they can take to improve outcomes for people with sickle cell disease?
It's not only what we're going to say, but we're going to provide even new information in the future. So what I'm going to tell you now is, number one, be aware of the disease. It's really disheartening. Out of the 100,000 people with sickle cell disease, only 25% receive the standard of care according to current guidelines. And that's just unacceptable. We can do better. And I know people want to do the right thing, but it's common enough that there's 100,000 people, but it's rare enough that you don't see a patient every day. So it's very important, and we're working on this very hard right now, is to make sure that the guidelines for how to take care of patients can be known and put into practice by everyone out in the community. Secondly, it's very important for patients to advocate for themselves. They have to know about their disease, and as we learned in medical school, listen to the patient and always listen to the grandmother, right?
Yes,
because they really, really know. But these people with sickle cell disease know when they're about to get into trouble. They sense the pain coming on. They sense the difficulty in breathing. So we have to empower them to advocate for themselves, that if they're not receiving the care that they know that they need, it is not wrong to question a physician or a nurse. Advocate for yourself. Make sure you get the care that you need, because if you don't, you could lose your life over that. I would much prefer a patient saying, you know, doc, I appreciate what you're doing, but I think I need something else. We want to have that feedback. So empower patients to advocate, really help the medical community learn. And I think we need new systems in. We don't have good data for sickle cell disease. We can't really track where people are, where they need the care. And if we can do those kind of things, we might be able to provide specialized centers so that patients can receive the care in a specialized way when they need it. And finally, one thing that I am really passionate about as a pediatrician is we have a problem with sickle cell disease and a lot of other diseases that are taken care of in a children's hospital, which are highly specialized, usually very well financed, and they're geographic in a way that you might only have one children's hospital in a geography. But when sickle cell patients and other patients grow into adulthood, all of a sudden they're kind of shot out into this enormous adult system that doesn't necessarily care for them in the way they've been cared for, and it's certainly a lot more diffuse, right? You have one children's hospital, but you might have 100 hospitals within that area. So that transition of care between being a patient in a pediatric center and being a young adult or an adult, particularly if you go to college, which often is out in the middle of rural America if you're in a land grant, how do we smooth those transitions so patients with sickle cell don't get caught in the gap without care?
Tremendous. So patient advocacy, physician awareness, making sure we have appropriate data and systems, and making sure the systems work for warm handoffs and transitions.
That's right. We want to be patient-centric. It's something you've always talked about. Think of the patient first. And again, your leadership in this area has been tremendous, and certainly in the area of pain control as well.
Well, and speaking of pain, you mentioned the excruciating pain that sickle cell patients sometimes go through. But unfortunately, we know that inappropriate treatment of pain has in many ways led us to the opioid epidemic. Can you talk about the balance between making sure we're appropriately providing pain management modalities and our desire to help physicians lower their overprescribing rates? And particularly, how does this affect sickle cell patients?
It's a very important question, and one that you've really provided national leadership on yourself. I think we need to be very careful when we provide the message is that we want to decrease inappropriate use of opioids. So if you have a tooth pulled, you don't need 30 days of opioids. And the American Dental Association has been very far out in front of that to make sure that, you know, that they're prescribing appropriately. Or if you have a knee replacement, you may need 1 or 2 days, not 90 days. So we want to decrease the inappropriate use. But there are patients who experience real and excruciating pain, like patients with sickle cell disease. And when they have that pain, often opioids are the best treatment. In the future, we hope we have others, but right now, they're often the best treatment. If you have cancer pain, for example, you may really need opioids. So we want to make sure that patients with sickle cell disease don't get swept up into the issues of opioid overprescribing because they really do need it. Now, what we hope in the future is that we can have systems that they don't have as much pain. If more than 25% got the standard of care for sickle cell disease, they wouldn't have so many pain crises. So our goal is to prevent the pain from actually happening in the first place. And of course, if you have a cure, you have a cure. But when a sickle cell patient comes into the emergency room, they often have excruciating pain. They often have severe anemia. So just imagine yourself in an emergency room, often as a young adult and often minority young adult, who has essentially lost 75% of your blood and you're in the most excruciating pain of your life. How does that make you feel? How vulnerable is that person? So we really want to make sure that we take care of them. And I can say now that we have tremendous support across the country. We just had a meeting with concerned emergency room physicians for sickle cell. First time I've ever seen a group like that who are emergency physicians who are banding together to improve the emergency room care of sickle cell, just so we don't have situations like we just stated. You have a poor, vulnerable patient who could be dying, to make sure that they get the appropriate care and the appropriate pain relief that all of us would expect.
I've often said stigma is one of our biggest killers. It sounds like sickle cell patients suffer from stigma too. Is that what you're saying?
You know, that's a very smart way to put it. I hope I could even say this without getting emotional about it, but when we first started talking about sickle cell at one of the first meetings of Minority Health, and I talked about sickle cell as one of my priorities, a young woman who I'd never met before came up to me and she said, for my entire life, I felt that sickle cell patients were always at the end of the line. For the first time in my life, I feel like we're moving up in line and maybe first. And I think that kind of epitomizes what you say about stigma. I think it's stigma, it's lack of knowledge, it's some stereotypes going on. We just need to break all of that. This is a real disease with real complications, with people not living the fullest life that they can live, but people who have some of the most potential because of their experiences. They grow up more quickly. They understand problems more deeply. I think they feel more with their heart. How awful is it? I mean, Shamanika has had probably a dozen of her friends in their 20s who have died in the last few years. Just imagine that. Just imagine putting yourself in those shoes and what it does to you, but also how it makes you grow and understand what's important in the world. I'd like to have those people contribute to our society for more than 38 years. I'd like them to live to 75 or 80 like the rest of us.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I can't let you out of here without talking about partnerships, because as you know, my motto is better health through better partnerships. Can you talk a little bit about some of the partnerships you'd like to see forged or improved upon as we tackle sickle cell disease?
Your leadership in the area of partnerships, I think, is really unparalleled. And I want to thank you personally for always hammering home the need for partnerships. And the basic idea here is, as big and as powerful as HHS is, we can't do it alone. You know, we need to work with all our interagency partners around government, but more importantly with that, we need to work with patient advocacy groups. We need to work with organizations like emergency room physicians, the American Society of Hematology, groups out there that are all working in this space, because this is not a whole of government approach. Mm-hmm. This has to be an entire whole of society approach and really look at ourselves. Sickle cell, it's the oldest known molecular disease. If we can't fix sickle cell or improve the lives of these patients, shame on us, right? I think it's within our power to do that, but it's going to require the leadership of yourself, Dr. Lin in Office of Minority Health, all the great people at HHS, including CDC, the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, tremendous people at NIH, people at CMS, at HRSA, all our agencies working together. And really for the first time, Dr. Lin and his team has brought the entire federal government around a single table to work together. And that's the first step. He's also brought private groups all together around that same table. And we're building an aggressive, bold agenda. I'm not talking about improvements in 20 years. I'm talking about improvements in 6 months, in 12 months, in 18 months, so that we can tell people with sickle cell disease, help is on a way. We hear your call, we hear your need, and we're going to do something about it.
Well, this has just been a tremendous conversation about a disease that we can cure. And in the meantime, we can make significant progress towards improving the lives of over 100,000 individuals in our country. Thank you so much, Admiral Giroir. Thank you all for joining us today for this conversation. We really appreciate the time, and we look forward to continuing conversations on ways that HHS, the Office of the Assistant Secretary for Health, and the Office of the Surgeon General can extend lives and protect patients across the country.
Produced by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services at taxpayer expense.